ready, and 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3.
Welcome back. Good to see you all. Hope that you had a wonderful lunch. I know I did. My house is not very far from here, so I'm able to go home to eat. It's very, very important for us to continue what we were studying this morning. If you remember, there's a section of the syllabus that I passed by. Do you remember that? The announcement of the Passover? Before we deal with that, however, I want to review the main elements of the Passover that we studied in our last session this morning. And then I want to go back and deal with the announcement of the Passover. So I'm going to just go through the details point by point very quickly so that we can catch a composite picture of the meaning of the Passover. First of all, Moses is the deliverer, right? Who is the deliverer in the fulfillment? Jesus is the deliverer. Was Israel in bondage? Yes. Were God's people in bondage? Absolutely. Who had Israel in bondage? The great dragon. Who had God's people in bondage when Jesus came? The great dragon. Could Israel deliver itself? No. Could human beings release themselves? No. So what did Israel do? They cried out. What was the human race doing before Jesus came? They were crying out. They were crying out for a deliverer. And then, of course, the deliverer is born in Egypt. Was Jesus also born to deliver us? Absolutely. Did Herod try to kill the children 2 years and younger? Absolutely. Did that happen to Moses? For sure. Now, why did God intervene to deliver God's people in the Old Testament? To be faithful to His what? To His covenant. Is that true also of the coming of Jesus? Was it to be faithful to His covenant? Remember, we read that. Was there a time prophecy that indicated when the sacrifice of the Lamb was going to take place? Yes. Is there a time prophecy about the fulfillment of that in Jesus Christ? Yes, the prophecy of the 70 weeks. Was the Lamb chosen before the Lamb was actually sacrificed? Yes. Was Jesus marked before He was actually sacrificed? Certainly. You remember that the Lamb was to be 1 year old. Was Jesus sacrificed when He was old? No. Was He sacrificed when He was a baby? No. It was when He had reached maturity. The Lamb had no blemish. Jesus had no blemish. No bones of the Passover Lamb were broken. No bones of Jesus were broken. You have the idea of substitution in both the Passover and in the fulfillment. We also have the idea that it wasn't sufficient to kill the Lamb. The blood also had to be applied. And the flesh had to be eaten. Does that have significance for us today in the fulfillment period? Absolutely. The blood was applied with what? Hyssop represents purity. Does the blood of Jesus applied to our heart cleanse us from all sin? 1 John chapter 1 and verse 7. Israel had to eat bitter herbs. Did Jesus have a bitter experience on the cross? He most certainly did. Israel was to have no leaven. Did Jesus have any leaven of sin within Himself? Absolutely not. The sacrifice of the Passover lamb had to be a whole sacrifice. Did Jesus make an entire whole sacrifice? That He did. Did the Passover take place at a particular month, a particular day, and a particular time? Yes. Did Jesus die on that month, that day, and that time? Absolutely. What is it that takes the place of the Passover? The Lord's Supper takes the place of the Passover. Now we want to backtrack a little bit. On page 39 of your syllabus, we have the announcement of the fulfillment of the Passover in Jesus. Now we're going to go directly to the fulfillment of the Passover and the announcement that was made concerning the Passover event. I want to begin by reading a statement that we find in the book Desire of Ages, page 77, where Ellen White is referring to the unleavened bread, the first fruits, and of course the slain lamb of the Passover. And she says in this short statement, the slain lamb, the unleavened bread, the sheaf of first fruits represented whom? Represented the Savior. Now, when Jesus was about to fulfill the Passover, was it necessary to have a lot of publicity so that all eyes could be riveted upon Jesus and see what he was about to do? Absolutely. Something very important was going to happen, and everybody in Jerusalem needed to know what was going to happen. They needed to have their eyes focused on Jesus. What event focused all of the eyes upon Jesus? It was what is called the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. It is also called by Christians in general Palm Sunday, because the people, you know, they put palms along the way as Jesus was coming into Jerusalem mounted upon a donkey. Now, what we're going to study in the next few minutes, I want you to remember the details. Because what happened at the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem once again happened leading up to 1844. Almost identical, the whole process that took place when Jesus entered into Jerusalem at the triumphal entry, the experience was repeated with the Advent movement leading up to 1844. And when we come to the Day of Atonement and the Feast of Trumpets, we're going to show the parallels between this and that time. Now, let's read Matthew 21 and verses 1 through 7 so that you can see the staging of the triumphal entry. It says, "Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, "The Lord has need of them." And immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. Now, Ellen White has a couple of very significant statements on the staging of this event by Jesus Christ. You'll notice that it was staged by Jesus, right? It was planned by Jesus. So if anyone was to blame for the disappointment that came afterwards, it would be whom? Jesus. It would appear that it would be Jesus, because he's the one that staged the whole event, and he knew that they were going to be disappointed. Notice these two statements from Ellen White. Desire of Ages, page 570. Christ was following the Jewish custom for a royal entry. So he's entering Jerusalem as a what? As a king. That's right. The animal on which he rode was that ridden by the kings of Israel, and prophecy had foretold that thus the Messiah should come to his kingdom. So Jesus is especially staging his coming into Jerusalem as a king. Were the Jews expecting a king? Of course they were expecting a king, but of course the wrong kind of king. Notice Desire of Ages, page 571. Never before in his earthly life had Jesus permitted such a demonstration. He clearly foresaw the result. So of course the question is then, why did he do it? Remember this, because we're going to deal with something similar that happened leading up to 1844. She continues writing, "It would bring him to the cross, but it was his purpose thus publicly to present himself as the Redeemer. For what purpose? He desired to call attention to the sacrifice that was to crown his mission to a fallen world. So what was the purpose of the triumphal entry? The purpose was for all eyes to be riveted on Jesus. And he was entering Jerusalem as a king, knowing full well that the Jews were expecting a king, but not the kind of king that he was going to be at that particular moment. Let me ask you, was the triumphal entry that was an announcement of the Passover a sweet experience for those who participated in this experience? Oh my, was it ever? Let me just read you two statements from the Spirit of Prophecy, once again from Desire of Ages, page 570. But hope brightened in there, that is in the disciples' hearts, with the joyous thought that he was about to enter the capital, proclaim himself king, and assert his royal power. While on their errand, they communicated their glowing expectations to the friends of Jesus, and the excitement spread far and near, raising the expectations of the people to the highest pitch. Can you almost feel the environment of this moment when Jesus was going to come into Jerusalem? Ellen White continues writing on the same page, 570, no sooner was he seated upon the colt than a loud shout of triumph rent the air. The multitude hailed him as Messiah, their king. Jesus now accepted the homage which he had never before permitted, and the disciples received this as proof that their glad hopes were to be realized by seeing him established on the throne. The multitude were convinced that the hour of their emancipation was at hand. Was their hour of emancipation at hand? Was it? Oh yeah, but not the kind of emancipation they were thinking about. She continues writing. In imagination, they saw the Roman armies driven from Jerusalem and Israel once more an independent nation. All were what? Happy and excited. The people vied with one another in paying him homage. So you can sense the excitement that was taking place. Ellen White describes that the disciples were the ones that first began the procession. Then they were joined by those who were traveling to Jerusalem for the feast. And finally, they were joined by all of those who lived in Jerusalem. And then she explains that as Jesus neared the eastern gate, the crowd grew larger and ever larger. And their voices of praise, she says, could be heard echoing on the hills. Those from whom Jesus cast out demons, I'm just amplifying what Ellen White has to say in Desire of Ages. Those from whom Jesus had cast out demons joined the procession, as did the blind whose eyes he had opened, the paralytics whose legs he had restored, the lepers he had cleansed, the widows and the orphans he had encouraged, even the dead that he had resurrected were among the throng. In fact, she says that Lazarus was leading the procession. Interestingly enough, the Bible describes this joyous occasion and this excitement in Matthew 21, verses 8 through 11. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes, he had lots of followers in the good times, didn't he? Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? So the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. Were all of the eyes in Jerusalem riveted upon Jesus? You better believe it. The whole city was in a tumult. All the eyes were focused upon Jesus. This was providential. Luke 19 also describes this triumphal procession. It adds some details. We're told there, then as he was drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, Blessed is whom? Is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now we have a group that's not too excited about this movement. Who are the ones that are not excited? The established church and the leadership of that church are not particularly excited about what is happening. Was the establishment happy leading up to the year 1844 with the message that the Millerites were preaching? No. The people were expelled from the churches. Ellen White and her whole family were disfellowshipped from the Methodist Church because they would not give up their Millerite teachings. The establishment arose against the message of the Millerites. I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit because I want you to be thinking forward to how this once again took place in a very similar way leading up to the year 1844. Of course, the question is, why would Jesus stage this event, choreograph this event? Even if eyes are focused on him, why would he choreograph this event? What would be the ultimate purpose? He knew that they were going to be disappointed. In Desire of Ages, page 571, we have the explanation. The events connected with the triumphal entry would be the talk of every tongue and would bring Jesus before every mind. After his crucifixion, many would recall the events in their connection with his trial and death. They would be led to search the prophecies and would be convinced that Jesus was the Messiah, and in all lands, converts to the faith would be multiplied. So was it worthwhile to have all eyes focused on Jesus, even if they were going to misunderstand what was going to take place? Certainly. So would it be any different leading up to 1844, where it would be important for all eyes to be riveted upon what Jesus was going to do, even though people misunderstood the event that was going to take place? You see, history runs in cycles. History is a series of parallels. Because the devil is always the same, human nature is always the same, and God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So you put those three constants together, and history what? History repeats itself. Jesus could not have chosen a better time, because this was the period of one of the harvest festivals, when all males 12 years and older, as well as most of them with their families, would be in Jerusalem. Then they would return to their lands and they would tell the great things that they had seen. But did these people misunderstand the event that was going to take place at the triumphal entry? They most certainly did. Was Jesus fulfilling a specific time prophecy when he came into Jerusalem? Yes. He was going to cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease at the middle of the last of the 70 weeks. He was fulfilling a prophecy. Did they misunderstand the meaning of that prophecy? They did. By the way, was Jesus really a king? Yes, he was. I don't know whether you have noticed this, but there is all sorts of royal language connected with Jesus in the last days of his life before his passion and his death. Let's notice this in the section that we find at the bottom of page 41. Was Jesus a king? Yes. Was he the kind of king that they expected? No. Notice, first of all, that just a few days before Jesus died on the cross, he pronounced those words in John chapter 12, where he said, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out." What was Jesus saying? He was saying, "I'm going to knock the ruler of this world off the throne, and I am going to take the throne." Not the throne of glory, but the throne of grace. You see, there are two different thrones. Now, did Jesus have a triumphal procession like kings had when they were going to be coronated. Absolutely. We just read about it in the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Were kings anointed with oil? You remember when David was anointed by Samuel? His head was anointed with what? With oil. Was Jesus, the head of Jesus, anointed with oil? Yes, by Mary. You can read this. Was a crown placed on the head of Jesus? Yes, it was a crown of thorns. It wasn't a crown of glory because he was going to be a king of the kingdom of grace. He was going to die to institute his spiritual kingdom. In other words, was a royal robe placed upon Jesus? Yes, a robe of purple. Who wore purple? Kings wore purple. Did they pay Jesus mock homage as a king? Oh, behold, the king of the Jews. Was Jesus, so to speak, given a scepter in his hand? Yeah, he was given the reed. And then they hailed him in a mocking way as the king. Was Jesus introduced by Pilate as a king? Yes, he said, behold, your what? King. Was there a procession to the place of Jesus' coronation on the cross? Yes. Was there a royal inscription that was placed upon the cross? Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Somehow I think that God wants us to know that he was a king. But he was not the kind of king that they were what? The kind of king that they were expecting. And so they suffered what? A bitter disappointment. Was Jesus to blame for the disappointment? No. Had Jesus tried to warn them what he was going to do in Jerusalem repeatedly, but they misunderstood prophecy. They just didn't get it. Notice one example, Matthew 16, 21 and 22. Matthew 16, 21 and 22 speaks about one of those occasions when Jesus told the disciples clearly he was going to be killed. How did they miss it? Because they interpreted prophecy in the light of what they wished to have. They loved Jesus and they wanted Jesus to proclaim himself as king. They misunderstood prophecy. It says there in Matthew 16, 21 and 22, this is the experience at Caesarea Philippi where Peter confessed that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. From that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. I mean, what part of be killed don't you get? And raised the third day. What part of that is ambiguous and unclear? Jesus tried to warn them repeatedly. They were disappointed not because of the fault of Jesus, but because of their own misapprehension of Bible prophecy. But the Bible tells us in John 12, verse 16, something very interesting. His disciples did not understand these things at first when Jesus spoke them. But when Jesus was glorified, that is, after Jesus resurrects and he's glorified, then they remembered that these things were what? Written about him, and that they had done these things to him. So were they going to study prophecy after the fact and say, now we understand why we got it wrong. Now we understand that he was going to be a different kind of king than we expected. Was that going to happen according to this verse? Absolutely. So would it be such a strange thing for the Millerites after 1844, October 22, 1844, to restudy Bible prophecy and say, now, we were wrong about the event. There's nothing new under the sun. You see, the whole Christian church was based on a great disappointment. So if the remnant church originates with a great disappointment, let's not be too hard on the remnant church because it happened before. And so they are bitterly disappointed. And you can sense this by the tone of one of the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. By the way, we know the name of one of them was Cleophas. We don't know the name of the other. There were two disciples of Jesus, not of the 12, two followers of Jesus. Two of the lesser known followers of Jesus. We know the name of one and we don't know the name of the other. And it's very interesting that the same type of thing happened after the Great Disappointment in 1844. And we'll discuss that. What did they say? But we trusted that it had been He which should have redeemed Israel. This was the day of the resurrection before they realized that Jesus had resurrected. Were they deeply disappointed? They expected Him to be the Redeemer. Was He the Redeemer? Yes, not the kind of Redeemer that they expected. In fact, we can catch this attitude of sorrow in Mark 16, 9 and 10 by the attitude of the women. It says there, "Now when He rose early on the first day of the week, He appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom He had cast seven demons. She went and told those who had been with Him as they what? As they mourned and as they wept." So the day that Jesus was crucified, the day that He was in the tomb, and the day that He resurrected before they knew that He had resurrected were days of sorrow, days of crying, days of suffering, because they had been bitterly disappointed because they misunderstood Bible prophecy. But did everybody give up their faith? You know, most of those who had been involved in the triumphal entry, multitudes, how many of those were with Jesus after crunch time? Most of them forsook the movement. And there was only a very small remnant left. Let's notice Mark 15, 12 through 15. "So they cried out again." This is some of the same people in the group that participated in the triumphal entry. "Crucify Him." "Then Pilate said to them, 'Why? What evil has He done?' But they cried out all the more, 'Crucify Him.' So Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and he delivered Jesus after he had scourged Him to be crucified." And so many of those who had participated in the triumphal entry and had acclaimed Jesus as King now forsook the movement and turned against Him. And when the day of Pentecost comes around, how many are left in the upper room? 120 out of all that vast multitude. Now, how was the disappointment explained? Did they come to a realization after the great disappointment, the reason why they had been disappointed? Of course. What did they do? They went to the Old Testament scriptures and they restudied the prophecies that they had misunderstood. Notice Luke 24, 25 to 27, Jesus catches up to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. And we find this interesting conversation between Jesus and them. And then Jesus speaks these words to them. "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into His glory?" And now how is Jesus going to explain the disappointment? Because they've just said, "We thought He was going to be the one that would redeem Israel. That's how we read prophecy. And today's the third day since He was killed. Our enthusiasm has been totally squelched." And so how does Jesus explain their disappointment? It says, "And beginning where? At Moses." You know, I like to think that maybe Jesus explained to them the first three feasts. Probably He said to them, "You tell me, what happened at Passover? Oh, the lamb was sacrificed. How did John the Baptist introduce me?" Oh, some of the disciples were disciples of John the Baptist before they were disciples of Jesus. "Oh, behold the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world." What happened the day after Passover? It was a day of what? Unleavened bread. Did my body see corruption? No. What was presented on the day after the beginning of unleavened bread? The first fruits were way before the Lord. So now it starts dawning on them, how could we miss this? How could we see the Christ-centered significance of these prophecies? And so it says that beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Incidentally, in the translation, you don't really catch what this is saying. If this was written in Hebrew, it would be, he explained in the Torah, which are the writings of Moses, the Nebi'im, which is the prophets, and the Ketubim, the writings. The Jews divided the Old Testament into three sections: the law, the prophets, and the writings. So Jesus here is saying, we're told here that Jesus took passages from where? From the entire Old Testament. Notice Luke 24, verse 32, the reaction of these two disciples that had misinterpreted Bible prophecy. They're going back to Jerusalem now to give the good news to the disciples, the well-known disciples who are hiding in the upper room. And they say, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? Had they studied those scriptures many times? Had their religious leaders instructed them in the scriptures? Of course they had. But it was a misapprehension of the scriptures. But now Jesus gives a new explanation of the scriptures. He shows how he is the center of the scriptures, and the hearts of the two disciples burn within themselves as he opens the scriptures to them. And then Luke 24, 33 to 35 tells us, so they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And they told about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. Remember the breaking of the bread, that's the feast of what? Of unleavened bread at this point. Now, Jesus then caught up to these two disciples and to the disciples that were gathered in the upper room. So now he has to explain the reason for the disappointment to the well-known apostles who are hiding for fear of the Jews. Notice Luke 24, verses 44 to 49, how Jesus explains the reason for their disappointment. Then he said to them, these are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. Where did Jesus speak to them from? From the Old Testament. So let's not demean the Old Testament Christians. You know, Christians say, you Adventists, you're Old Testament Christians. We're New Testament Christians. There's no such thing as a New Testament Christian. There's such a thing as a Bible Christian. You cannot understand the New Testament without the Old. And you can't understand the Old without the New. Amen. St. Augustine said, the old, the new is in the old concealed, and the old is in the new revealed. They work together. You can't separate the two testaments. The New Testament is the key that unlocks the Old Testament. And so the Jews, the problem with the Jews is they say, we go by the Old Testament and not by the New. Christians say, we go by the New and not by the Old. Adventists say, we go by the Old and the New, because we are Bible Christians. Continues saying, and he opened their understanding that they might what? Comprehend the scriptures. Then he said to them, thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations. Now he's referring to Pentecost, isn't he? Should be preached to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and you are witnesses of these things. And now he's going to make a reference to the day of Pentecost. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. And then Jesus spends the next 40 days on earth with his disciples. What did Jesus do during those 40 days? We're told in Acts chapter 1, verse 3. First of all, he appeared to many to show that the resurrection took place. And secondly, he spoke to them concerning the kingdom of God, the things concerning the kingdom of God. What does that mean? It means that he explained to them what? The prophecies. Did Peter on the day of Pentecost understand prophecy such he has never understood before? Did he understand Psalm 16, where it says that the body of the Messiah would see no corruption? Did he understand Psalm 110, verse 1, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool? Absolutely. You see, now Peter is enlightened on the day of Pentecost. He is using the prophecies of the Old Testament to speak about the fulfillment on the day of Pentecost. Where did he learn to interpret the scriptures that way? During the 40 days in which Jesus spoke to them concerning the kingdom of God, the things concerning the kingdom of God. Incidentally, did Jesus then, after the great disappointment and after instructing his disciples, did Jesus now enter a new phase in his ministry? Yes. Where did he enter? He entered the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. What did the religious establishment say about the argument of Peter that Jesus had entered the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary? They said that it was a deception, that it was an afterthought, that they gave this explanation to save face, that Jesus had begun a new ministry in the holy place. Does this sound familiar to what happened in 1844? You know, Adventists are still taken to the shed, so to speak, by other Christians. They say, oh, you Adventists, you know, your church began with a great disappointment. How can a true church begin with a great disappointment? Well, the fact is that the Christian church began with a disappointment and with a misapprehension of Bible prophecy, which was clarified by a further study of Bible prophecy. And by the way, in the days of Christ, Jesus entered a new ministry in the holy place after 1844, or in 1844, Jesus entered a new phase of his ministry in the most holy place. And you know what many Christians say? They say, oh, you Adventists, you invented that idea of the investigative judgment in 1844 to save face. See, you added this explanation afterwards so that you wouldn't look so ridiculous. The same accusation was launched at the apostles. So be very careful about launching accusations. What happened with all of the Jewish denominations, so to speak? They all turned against Jesus and the disciples. What happened in the aftermath of 1844? All of the different Christian denominations turned against this little remnant that restudied prophecy and concluded that Jesus, instead of coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, had begun a new phase of ministry in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. In fact, we find several evidences that the establishment and its leaders turned against Jesus and the disciples. You have several mentions here. The establishment rebuked the uneducated disciples, children, and infants who were acclaiming Jesus as their king. They probably said, what do little children know about the Messiah? What does this ignorant fisherman know? What does somebody who was resurrected from the dead, Lazarus, what does he know about Bible prophecy? We are the scholars. The people ought to listen to our interpretation of the scriptures. But we're told here in Matthew 21, 15 and 16, but when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant and said to him, do you hear what these are saying? And Jesus said to them, yes. Have you never read out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise. Desire of Ages, page 574. Many Pharisees witnessed the scene, and burning with envy and malice, sought to turn the current of popular feeling. With all their authority, they tried to silence the people. Did the religious leaders leading up to 1844 try to silence the message of the Millerites? Oh yeah, just read the book The Midnight Cry by F.D. Nichol. That'll give you the whole story of the movement that led to 1844. Churches were closed. The leadership told their members, don't go there. People were disfellowshipped from their churches for embracing the Millerite message. So there's nothing new under the sun. It is significant, now listen carefully to this, it is significant that immediately after the triumphal entry, Jesus proclaimed the fall of the Jewish nation. Let me ask you, when did the papacy fall? Where there's no turning back? 1798. When did apostate Protestantism fall where there's no coming back? In 1844. The Spirit of Prophecy makes that very clear. They're not going to turn back. Right after the triumphal entry, we find Jesus speaking of the fall of the Jewish nation. He gives the parable of the fig tree, which is an acted parable, the parable of the vineyard workers, the parable of the great banquet. He then rebukes the scribes and the Pharisees, and he says, the kingdom is going to be taken from you. Is it any coincidence that Jesus would predict that the Jewish nation would fall now because they rejected the message that Jesus had shared and the disciples had shared? Less than a week after the triumphal entry, the Sanhedrin sentenced Jesus to death. On the cross, the scribes and the chief priests and the elders mocked and reviled Jesus. The religious establishment, hardened in rebellion, even attempted to hide the truth about his resurrection, saying that the disciples had invented the story of the resurrection to save face. Christ's faithful followers had to hide from the wrath of the Jews. They were gathered in the upper room for fear of the Jews, according to John 20 and verse 19. The church of that day fell and became apostate because it did not follow Jesus in his sanctuary work in the camp and in the court. Do you know the surest formula for apostasy is not following Jesus step by step in his work? What would have happened if the Protestant world had entered with Jesus into the most holy place in 1844? What would they be saying about the law of God? Because the Ark of the Covenant has the Ten Commandments, and in the middle of the Ten Commandments is the Sabbath commandment, right? So what would the Christian world be saying about the law of God if they had entered the most holy place in 1844 with Jesus? Oh, they'd be saying, the law is still binding because Jesus went into the most holy place. The ark is there and the Ten Commandments are inside the ark. What would they be saying about the Sabbath? They'd be saying, oh, the Sabbath, that's the day we're supposed to keep. Ten Commandments are inside the Ark of the Covenant and the Sabbath is at the center of the Ten Commandments. What does the Christian world say about the Ten Commandments? They were nailed to the cross. What do they say about the Sabbath? It was for the Jews because they haven't gone into the most holy place where these truths are especially revealed. What does the Christian world say about the judgment, the investigative judgment? They say, oh, those Adventists, they believe that Jesus is going to investigate the cases of those who claimed the Lord in heaven beginning in 1844. They say, no, that's not the case. A person is judged when they die. So this has to do with the state of the dead, doesn't it? If the judgment begins at a certain point in time in 1844, then nobody went to heaven or to hell before they died because God would not take them to heaven before they were judged. Amen. Are you with me? Yes. So the Adventist view that the dead are dead until the judgment fits perfectly with our view of the judgment. What does the Christian world say about the dead? They said the dead know everything. In other words, the soul leaves the body, and the soul, if the person was good, goes to heaven and continues living in heaven. And if the person was wicked, they go to hell. And if the person was not so wicked and not so righteous, they go to purgatory. And if the person had not reached the age of accountability, then they go to a place called limbo. The The Bible doesn't talk about purgatory or limbo. And the Bible says that the judgment begins at a certain day. God has established a day for the judgment, according to Acts 17 and verse 30 and verse 31. So that means that before the judgment, people didn't go to heaven or hell when they died. What does the Christian world say about what you should eat and drink? They say, listen, folks, your prayer sanctifies your pork chop. God now blesses what he once cursed. That's what they say. But the pot of manna in the Ark of the Covenant teaches that God wanted Israel to have a healthy vegan diet. Doesn't the manna teach not only the Sabbath, but doesn't it teach healthful eating too? It most certainly does. Remember when Israel got tired of the manna, they said, oh, we're tired of this vegan food. Give us a good rich food of Egypt. So the manna also taught the lesson of what? Of healthful living. Listen, the truths that the Christian world rejects are the distinctive truths of the Adventist Church that are revealed in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And they don't see them because they have not entered there with Jesus. They are still in the court or in the holy place. Are you with me or not? Amen. And so I hope that this introduction to the Passover and also introduction to 1844 has been helpful, because we're going to come back to this when we deal with the Day of Atonement. All right, I didn't intend to take that long, but I think it was worth it, wasn't it? Let's go now to page 63. Page 63. Actually, there's right before that, page 61. Not page 63, but page 61 in your syllabus. The Feast of Unleavened Bread. And I'm just going to mention some very short introductory things, and then the rest of the time this afternoon I want to dedicate to the material that we find beginning on page 63. The Feast of Unleavened Bread began on the 15th day of Nisan, the day after Passover, in other words. This feast represents the burial of Jesus, his rest in the tomb, and his appearances to his followers multiple times during the week after the resurrection. Did Jesus show his body to his followers in the course of the whole week after his resurrection? Absolutely. His body is the unleavened bread, we're going to see. His flesh is the unleavened bread. Now, let's go down to the middle of the page. In the Hebrew feast system, the first day of unleavened bread was a ceremonial Sabbath. However, during Passion Week, this is important, the seventh day Sabbath fell on the same day as the ceremonial Sabbath. So the first day of unleavened bread was a ceremonial Sabbath. That would be the 15th of Nisan. But it just so happens that that day was also the seventh day Sabbath. Are you with me? For this reason, the Sabbath that Jesus rested in the tomb was called what kind of Sabbath? It was a high Sabbath. It was a high day, in other words. And the reason why is because it was a double Sabbath. It was a ceremonial Sabbath, and it was also the seventh day Sabbath. John 19 and verse 31 tells us as much. Therefore, because it was the preparation day, that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a what? A high day. The Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Now let's go to the following page. I'm skipping a few paragraphs here because I do want to dedicate a full hour to the material beginning on page 63. Let's go to the top of page 62. Luke 23, verse 53, through Luke 24, verse 1, gives us the sequence of days very clearly. We find here the following description. Then he took it down, that is the body of Jesus, wrapped it in linen, and this is Joseph of Arimathea, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock where no one had ever lain before. And then it tells us what day that was. That day was the preparation. What do we call Friday? called Preparation Day, right? In my household, Thursday is the preparation for the Preparation Day. That's house cleaning day. So we're not running around the last minute on Friday trying to clean the house. But anyway, you know, we need to prepare for the Sabbath every day. In other words, after the Sabbath, when the Sabbath ends, on Sunday, we need to start preparing for the following Sabbath. So anyway, that was the preparation. That day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near. So what would the next day be after the preparation day? The Bible's so clear. And it continues saying, and the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they what? They rested on the Sabbath day according to the commandment. Which commandment? Fourth commandment, obviously, according to the commandment. Now, when did Jesus resurrect? Now, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. Do you see the sequence in this passage? What day was Jesus crucified and laying in the tomb? Friday. Which day did the women rest and Jesus rest in the tomb? The Sabbath day, according to the commandment. Which day did Jesus resurrect from the tomb? The first day of the week. Now, what part of that is not clear? The Bible's absolutely clear on this point. Now, the very day that Jesus rested in the tomb is the day that he rested from his work of creation. What day did Jesus finish his work at creation? The sixth day, right? In fact, in Genesis, you'll find it says that the heavens and the earth were finished in 6 days. That's the word that's used in the book of Genesis, chapter 2. So Jesus worked 6 days, and then what did he do on the seventh day? He ceased from his works. The word Shabbat there, the word rested in Genesis 2 verses 2 and 3, is the Hebrew word Shabbat. It does not describe quality of rest. It simply means to cease. It means to stop doing something. In other words, to work no more. So what did Jesus do after he finished his work? By the way, on the sixth day he said, it is finished. Just like at creation it says that he finished. So he says on the cross, it is finished. And then he breathes his last and he rests in the tomb on Sabbath. In other words, he ceases from his work of redemption. You know, we use the same word, the word rest, in a similar way today. You know, when a trial is going forward, the district attorney finishes presenting his case, and he says to the judge, the prosecution rests. Does that mean that the prosecution is going to Hawaii on vacation? No. It simply means that the prosecution has finished and has nothing more to present. And so Jesus rests. He ceases from his work of redemption on the Sabbath. And by the way, the crucifixion took place only on a portion of Friday. Jesus resurrected from the tomb on the first day of the week, but it was only a portion of the first day of the week. The only day where Jesus lay in the tomb from sundown to sundown was on the Sabbath day. Notice this statement from Ellen White. This is manuscript 25, 1898. She says, the death of Christ was designed to be at the very time in which it took place. It was in God's plan that the work which Christ had engaged to do should be completed on a Wednesday. Just making sure that after lunch, you're awake. It was in God's plan that the work which Christ had engaged to do should be completed on a Friday. When was Jesus crucified? Friday, folks, not Wednesday. Friday. You know, you can question that, but you're questioning inspiration. You're questioning the spirit of prophecy. And that on the Sabbath, he should rest in the tomb. Why? Even as the Father and the Son had rested after completing their creative work, the hour of Christ's apparent defeat was the hour of his victory. The great plan devised before the foundations of the earth were laid was successfully carried out. So Jesus did in redemption what he did at creation. He rested from his works of redemption. Now, you've heard the debate going on in the Adventist church. Maybe some of you have. Did Jesus complete his work on the cross, or is he still continuing his work in heaven? Was the atonement completed at the cross? That's the big question. And you know, some scholars say, well, no, his work of salvation was completed on the cross. The atonement was completed on the cross. And so you can't say that the Day of Atonement, an atonement is going on, because the atonement was finished at the cross. Well, you know, really, it's a discussion that shouldn't even exist when you really understand the implications of what we're talking about. Let me ask you, was provision for salvation totally and absolutely complete when Jesus died on the cross? Was there a perfect robe of righteousness for every person who has ever lived? Yes. Was there a payment of the penalty for sin for every person who has ever drawn breath in the history of the world? Absolutely. Provision was complete, but the application of the provision still needed to take place in the heavenly sanctuary. Are you with me? So the atonement was completed in the sense of provision, but the atonement was not completed in the sense of application to individuals of the provision that was made in the atonement. So to argue whether the atonement was completed on the cross, you know, what would your answer be? Your answer would be yes and no. You know, I hate that kind of an answer, yes and no. Because it has to be yay, yay, or nay, nay, Jesus said, right? But in this case, it all depends how you look at it. Because the atonement was finished in terms of provision, but the atonement was not finished in terms of application to individuals and the cleansing of the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we have studied the introductory remarks into the Feast of Unleavened Bread. In our next hour together, we are going to study about the manna episode. It is intimately related with the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So don't miss the next exciting episode.